guilty, why would you not want to invoke your rights? If you're guilty, what are you trying to do?
Not what you're doing.
You're trying to appear innocent, right? So if you're trying to appear innocent and the innocent person wouldn't invoke the rights because they want to, you know, because they have nothing to hide, so you, even being guilty, would probably not want to invoke your rights because you want to appear innocent, right? Additionally, the detectives usually de-emphasize it. They make it as a kind of a, they make it seem like it's kind of a, just a minor standard procedure. You just sign this thing and then we move on, right? It doesn't, they don't actually make it clear that it's a big deal, right? That you right now are waiving your constitutional rights and shit's gonna happen to you now, right? So, innocent people want to appear that they have nothing to hide, want to show that they have nothing to hide. Guilty people want to appear like they're full braid up and they don't want to, you know, and appear innocent. And so again, they're invoking, waiving the rights. And most suspects don't actually understand what that means. Most suspects also don't understand that even after you waived your rights, you can still retract. You can go back and say, okay, now I see this is not going the way I expected, so I stop talking now, or like, I want my lawyer now. They don't actually think it's possible. And most of the time, the police are not gonna tell them, you know, by the way, even though you signed this paper, it's okay, like you can change your mind whenever. That's not something that you're told. And so once you waive it, this is it. The biggest problem is that it's really working against the innocent people. Why? Because innocent people think their innocence is somehow transparent. That just because they're innocent, the police is gonna see that they're innocent, right? That it's clear that they're innocent, that they're gonna figure it out, that nothing bad can happen to them because they're innocent, and so they're at the highest risk, right? Sorry. Now, the problem is also that these kinds of the questions are a lot of times not actually understood, right? So, as I said, voluntarily, knowingly, and intelligently. Problem, most people don't actually understand and appreciate what that actually means. A lot of suspects, particularly if they are youths, they're young, they're kids or teenagers or adolescents, they don't understand what that means. People with mental retardation, they don't understand what that means. A lot of the suspects, for them, the language is beyond their comprehension, right? And so they're signing something, they say that, yeah, I understood, but they don't. If you check, and research shows that they're actually not understanding what they're signing. And so we think, right, the youth suspects need special protection. A lot of cases have shown that youth need special considerations and special rights, including in the context of interrogation. And the likelihood of false confession for younger people is at a much higher rate. Nonetheless, and we have a provision that says, okay, parents can actually be present during an interrogation. Is that gonna help? What do you think? No, because parents, A, also have no idea what's going on. B, actually try to tell their kid, they're telling their kid, confess. Tell them, say it, and so the kid kid sitting there. Now, imagine, again, you guys sitting with your high, you know, high kind of stance there thinking, oh, you know, this, that, parents, understand, like, whatever, not that hard. Imagine the situation. You're in the room, there's two big detectives toppling over you, there's this kid, and your parent, both parent and you, terrified, no idea what's going on. And your parent is telling you, come on, just tell them. Say, like, not helpful, right? So, really, if you're ever in a situation, the only thing you need to do is say, I want my lawyer. So, now that we've talked about the safeguard and how they're not actually helpful, let's talk about the interrogation process. So what's happening when the suspect gets into a police department and they're trying to get the truth, supposedly, right? You know, interrogations have a very long history, right? You've probably heard some scary stories about the medieval torture devices and other ways of getting people to talk. Most of the early methods included physical and psychological torture. Now, in the early 1960s, this guy, Reed, police officer, investigator, came up with this technique that he called the Reed technique. Known as the Reed technique. And it's supposed to be very, useful and very effective in getting people to confess. The Reed technique, and it's not just about confessions, it's also about detection of deception. Now you remember, hopefully, the lecture that Dr. Hartwig gave you about deception detection and how we stop in it, right? So keep that in mind. Now, the two-stage interrogation process, two-stage process of the Reed technique includes the interview and the interrogation. Very important distinction. So, the process of what's happening, right? You have the crime, has been committed, and then there's a suspect that was apprehended. And then the suspect is interviewed by a police officer informally. The Reed technique suggests that it actually should happen outside of the police department, preferably in a place that is comfortable for the suspect, maybe their house or you know, the street or the car, somewhere that's not in the interrogation room. And then the police officer makes a decision. If the police officer decides that the suspect is truthful, that they're saying the truth, then they're free to go. If the police officer decides, however, that the suspect is lying and hence is guilty, then they go on to the next step, which is the interrogation process.
It's a lot riding on one person's decision.
Are they any good at it? No, we know they're not, right? They have no idea what they're basing their decisions on in terms of determining if the person is actually telling the truth or lying. What's the other problem? What do we have in American justice system? Presumption of innocence, right? What do we have here? Presumption of guilt, right? The police, according to the Reed technique, do not interrogate innocent people. They don't interrogate innocent people, period. And that's why they don't take any false confessions, right? Because everybody who they interrogate is actually guilty. Whatever happened to the presumption of innocence, right? that the court is supposed to decide whether or not the person is guilty. At that point, they already have concluded that the person is guilty, and all they need to do is get them to confess. So how do they do that? The Reed technique has 9 steps. The first step is positive confrontation. I know you did it. I know you did it. I know X, Y, Z evidence. You know, I've seen you there, or you have a witness who saw you there. I have DNA. I have this. I have that. No way of denying it. I know it's you. That's kind of the first step. What do you remember about what Marie Hartwig told you about this whole concept of telling people up front the evidence? What happens there? What happens to the innocent person, where you told them already, like, this is all my evidence, so now
they start to think about it.
There's no way for you to tell the difference, because the innocent person, who could have accounted for the evidence in their ways, right, now is going to appear just as guilty trying to come up with a story, right, because there's no way for you to tell the difference between the two stories. So they give you this confrontation. And then theme development. This is the kind of the longest step that really is happening throughout the interrogation process. This is where the police officer comes up with a compelling story for why you have done it. So maybe you have just, you were cornered, you were so stressed out, and really it's your wife's own fault that you killed her because she's such a slut and she cheated on you, and so of course you could, it's totally understandable. Hey, anybody could have, anybody would have done the same if they were in the situation and all of that. So basically kind of giving you this very compelling story for why this is possible and why you've done it. All throughout, the interrogator is supposed to be assessing the suspect's behavior as if they're a psychologist. Stopping denials. Now, this is also kind of a very important step. So anytime the person tries to deny their guilt, to deny, no, it's not how it happened, no, I didn't do it, no, this is not what happened, the detective has to very abruptly stop any of these denials. Now, absence of denials indicates guilt. The interrogator is supposed to stop these denials before the suspect is even able to actually complete their sentences, right? So, again, imagine, and fine, okay, so if the person is guilty, maybe that could be working, but just imagine for a second, you sitting there having no idea why this is happening to you, and then you're trying to deny, as you're trying to say, tell your side of the story, they're in your face and stopping you, not letting you finish the sentence, right? Just imagine what's happening in your head at that moment and how you appear, right? Do you appear cool, calm, and collected? Probably not, right? What are the deception signs that everybody knows about that are not real ones? Fidgeting, right? Anxiety, you're nervous, right? That's the signs that everybody knows is about deception, right? What would anybody appear like when they're in a situation like this? So the next step is when the suspect suspect tries to propose reasons, supposedly, for why they didn't do it, right? So they're trying to oppose, to make actual sentences where they say, no, this is why I couldn't have done it, or this is why I didn't do it. And apparently, this is only done by guilty people. And that indicates that the interrogation is actually making progress. So for the interrogator, it's a good thing. Next step, getting the suspect's attention, right? So it might be something like, right? Something that will really make them startle, right? Physical gesture, something that is going to, you know, physical closeness, proximity, yelling, verbal insults, whatever works to get the suspect really at you. And so the next step, at that point, the suspect supposedly quiets and listens, right? Tears positively indicate guilt. If you cry, it must be because you're guilty, not because the police officer is yelling at you and you're terrified of what's going to happen and you're like fearing for your life at this point. No, it's because you're guilty. And it's not funny, by the way. It's what the actual manual says, right? That's what they're teaching police officers. So this step is the key step. Called the alternatives question. This is where the police officer offers you a face-saving alternative that will, one way or the other, indicate your guilt. So basically saying, so, did you kill this woman because you are a cold-hearted psychopath, or because you got mad at them and just kind of acted on the spur of the moment? Did you steal that money from the store because you needed it for drugs, or because you needed to feed your family? What's the problem here?
Either way,
whatever you say, you're guilty. You just admitted that you did it, right? So this is the key step, because either choice is an admission of guilt by fact, right? And this is the turning point of the interrogation process, because at that point, then the detective will kind of start actually getting you into the conversation and pulling you to start talking and developing that admission that you just did, right? And then, so that will be then witnessed by somebody where you actually already talk about whatever happened as if you did it. And then ultimately they will get you to sign a written confession. Usually they write it up, and then you sign it, and then voluntariness of the statement is established at this point. And so that's pretty much it. Right now, again, keeping in mind, thinking about if the person sitting in front of you is actually guilty, right, is the one that committed the crime, you may be saying, yeah, okay, maybe that works. You can break them down by doing all of that, and they will ultimately say the truth, right? But the problem is the original step, right, where they have no idea whether the person sitting there is actually guilty or not. Two key tactics that are part of the read technique that are very important to also remember, and you will probably hear about that as well from Jeff today. Maximization and minimization. Maximization is kind of scary, scare tactics, where the police officer will tell you, you will get the death penalty if you don't confess. I will put you in the jail with, you know, in the cell with the, you know, the craziest inmates, and they're going to do a number on you. Whatever exaggerated claims they can possibly make, that's kind of, that's it, right? Minimization is the other way. So, it's not a big deal what you've done. Anybody could have done it. It's actually not that much of a crime anyway, and maybe even you're gonna, you know, if you confess, we're gonna have you sign it, and you're gonna go home, and, you know, maybe you're gonna get, like, a probation sentence or something minor, no big deal. Really, and it's totally understandable what you did. Blaming the victim, you know, it's her own fault that it happened and all of that. So offering kind of face-saving, again, excuses, moral justification, all of that. Right now, you have to also keep in mind, and this is very important, police officers are allowed to lie to you in the interrogation room. So they can tell you, we have evidence against you. They can tell you, we have your fingerprints. They might not tell you, we have your fingerprints, but they will say, we have fingerprints. They might not tell you that they have your DNA, they will tell you, we have DNA. What does that tell you when you're sitting there as a suspect and they tell you, we have DNA? Does that sound like we have somebody else's DNA? No, right? We have a witness who can place you there, right? They can say these things, and that's not against the law, actually. Now, while this technique is the most widely used in the USA in across the police departments, there's no research that actually validates its use or its diagnosticity. By diagnosticity, I mean whether or not it can reliably distinguish between truthful and guilty or innocent and guilty suspects, or whether or not the confession is actually true or false, right? So there's no way to tell. The research does show that the technique is highly manipulative and psychologically coercive, and that the police officers who are trained in it believe that they're experts in identifying deception, and on the other hand are more biased towards guilt. So they're guilt presumptive, they're confident in their decision, and they're even less accurate than those who are not trained by this technique. This article actually shows that, if you want to read up on this. Right, so more guilt presumptive, more confident, less accurate. So what is supposed to be the goal of the interrogation process? It's supposed to be what?
No, it's supposed to be finding the first interrogating conspirator.
Finding the truth, right? But the problem is, this particular technique is basically geared towards getting a confession from whoever is sitting there, regardless of whether or not they're actually guilty or innocent, right? And we know through research time and time again that even every single part of the technique, we cannot possibly test it experimentally, we cannot make people go through all of these steps for obvious ethical reasons, but even small parts of it within a research context in a lab are shown to make both innocent and guilty people confess. Now, you might think, well, confession, okay, and that's actually what a lot of innocent people think, right? Well, I confess now, but then they're gonna figure it out. Because there's gonna be, you know, there's other evidence, and they're gonna test that DNA, and they're gonna find out it's not me, and all of that, right? Because supposedly, the fact finder, who's the police officer, right, is supposed to get all of these pieces of evidence from experts and fingerprints and DNA and eyewitnesses and all of that independently, right? It's supposed to happen independently, and then they get that, and if some, you know, one of the pieces is corrupt, it's okay, because other pieces will kind of be get together and show that this person is not the person to look for. But what in reality is happening is once you have the confession, everything else gets pretty much contaminated. Experts start changing their expert opinions, or they start seeing things that they haven't seen before, like being able to make out a license plate number out of like pixels that are impossible for any technology to piece together, right? Eyewitnesses start changing their accounts. Fingerprints experts start seeing matches where they didn't see any before. And so ultimately, everything starts to point to the same person, right? Once you have the confession, everything else pretty much is irrelevant. Nothing else matters, right? So it's a big problem. So false confessions, do they exist? As I said, confessions make a greater impact than even eyewitnesses. And according to this study that was done in 2004, 85% of cases that included a false confession resulted in a conviction, even when the confession is retracted, even when the jury are told that the confession was coerced, they still believe it's true. And as we now know, false confessions contribute to approximately, are part of approximately 30% of now known wrongful convictions, right? This number is even higher for those who are interrogated at a tender age of, you know, before 17, 18, right? So these guys, 14, 15, 16, particularly prone to influences and coercion. So yes, they do exist. And the average, according to the Innocence Project, the average number of years that people spent in prison for crimes they didn't commit is 14 years. Just think about that for a second. All right, so I'm gonna quickly talk about the types of false confessions that are that we know about, and then I will give the floor to our guests. So the first type, the voluntary false confession. This is kind of the least of our troubles, really. This is a false confession that people come into the police department and say, I did it. For no coercion, for no real kind of insight from the police at all. Most of the time people do that because either they want the fame and notoriety for the case, because there's something not quite right in terms of their mental capacity, or because they feel guilty or some past transgression, something they did before, or because they want to cover up for a dear loved one, such as a parent trying to protect their child and confessing for the crime that they that their child either did commit or they think they did, right? claimed, I did it. And the case yet remains unsolved.
Yep.
So it happens. But this is not really the problem that we are kind of talking about here today. The second type, the coerced compliant false confession. This is when the person actually knows, understands, fully aware of the fact that they didn't do it, and yet they confess. Why they do that? Because everything I've described to you as a situation that happens in the interrogation room, again, just imagine for a second that going on for 36 hours on end. You just want to stop it. Like, whatever happens after, at that point, doesn't matter. You just want to stop the situation, make it go away. And so, a lot of times people think, I can just withdraw the confession later, I can retract it, and or, well, the police is going to figure it out anyway, and so it's going to be fine. They're told by the interrogator, if you confess, you can go home. Like, once you sign this paper, you're going to be able to go home. And you might now think, but how could they believe that, right? You know, you understand that you... No, you don't. At that point, you don't actually understand the consequences, the distal consequences. You're not really thinking about it, because all you have is this little room and these people who are just breaking you down, right? And so you're trying to avoid the real or implied threat. Remember the maximization tactics that I've mentioned, right? And so you sign the paper. And the case examples you've probably heard about Central Park 5 case. Hopefully you've seen the movie as well. If you didn't, I really strongly recommend that you watch it. Jeffrey will talk about his case, so I'm not going to do that. But just so you understand, this is not a one-time thing. This is kind of the general path of how it happens to a lot of people. It's not it happened to this person, but it's just because them. No, it's not because them, it's because this is just a very, very stressful situation that that can impact people in that way. And then the third type is the most damaging one. This is where the person, throughout the course of the interrogation, because of the lying about evidence, because the police sometimes will tell the person that, you know, you may have just blacked out when because you were stressed or you were so traumatized and you blacked out, so you don't remember, right? Or close your eyes and try to imagine how that happened. And through that process, the person, even if for a split of a second, doubts their actual right mind, their memory, and starts thinking, maybe I actually did it. And a lot of times it happens to younger people, particularly when the interrogation process is especially lengthy. The person is tired, they're confused, they've been, you know, yelled at and confronted with these facts, they're hungry, they're thirsty, they get false feedback on about a polygraph test, they get a false information about the presence of DNA or other evidence, and so pretty much they kind of start believing that they've actually done it. Most of the time, they realize later on, once the situation is pretty quickly, they realize this, no, didn't really do it. But it's too late. mentally damaging for people, because just imagine, right? You believed for a second that you killed somebody, and you think this is the duty that you did, right? And then you confess, and then you realize, oh my God, what have I done, right? It's not just because you knew you didn't do it, but had to escape the situation. It's because you really believed it. So it's a very difficult thing to go through for the person. And I do want to mention Marty Tunkliff's case in this this context. So some of you may have heard about the case. Yes. So just briefly, Marty was 17 years old. He lived in Long Island with his parents, well-off upper middle class family. Everything was going well for him. And then suddenly he wakes up one morning and finds both his parents killed. Oh, his father was actually almost dead. His mother was dead. He was unconscious and bleeding. So he calls the police. And the detective arrives and thinks that Marty is not kind of reacting the way he should to a parent's death. And so he thinks he's not enough emotions, not crying, not emotional enough. So probably guilty. So they take him in. He's interrogated without the presence of an adult for some, I think it was 30 hours or something like that. Throughout this interrogation, the police tell him he must have blacked out when he killed them in the middle of the night. Then the detective, Marty, still maintains his innocence. He says, no, I didn't do it. The detective then makes up this, just imagine, right? He says that Marty's father woke up in the hospital, so he came to his consciousness, and said Marty did it, and then died. And so at that point, Marty's confused. Marty is used to believing his father. He's also not really expecting police to lie, right? Most people don't. And so at that point, he thinks, well, maybe I did. If they say I did it, must have done it. Now, he pretty much very quickly retracts back the confession, and he doesn't actually even sign it. They write it up, and he didn't sign it. Nonetheless, that was enough to convict him. 17 years he spent in prison before he got exonerated, 11 years ago now. And at the exoneration, the court decided that his confession was definitely coerced, and that without the confession, there was actually nothing else, absolutely nothing else. In fact, there's a whole other story to this case with the real culprit and corruption in the police department. There's a book about it if you're interested. You should definitely read it. And Marty ultimately got a compensation for the time he served, I think last year. Now you might think, oh, well, good for him. Is that ever going to get the years back? Nothing can possibly remedy what has been done. And in fact, most people don't even get compensation, because confess his own problem. So when somebody confesses, pretty much it affects everything throughout the system, right? The police stop the investigation at that point. They stop getting any evidence. They ignore any contradictory evidence. they refuse to admit any possibility of error. The prosecution sets a higher bail. They are asking for higher charges. They make the confession the centerpiece of the whole process. Even the defense attorney assumes you're guilty and pressures people to plead guilty. And so the jury, of course, like I said, confession very even if coerced, still very likely to convict. The judges would set a higher higher sentence. Why? Because you're not remorseful. Because you're not actually sorry for you for your crime. Because if you didn't do it and you maintain your innocence, it's like you didn't accept your, you know, your full, your responsibility, you're not showing remorse, and so higher sentence and very difficult to get appeals, very difficult to get parole hearings, to get release on parole. Why? What do you need, what do you think you need to get on parole, to get out on parole? You have to admit your guilt and show your remorse. If you didn't do it, how are you going to show that, right? So, I also want to point out in light of this, what's very important to remember. It's not just the one person who gets wrongfully convicted who is affected by this, right? Even though that would have been enough, you know, for this to be a huge issue. So the wrongfully accused person, right? They get all of the psychological consequences of false confession. They get, of course, their life shattered because they serve years and years in prison and all of that. But they're not the only ones, right? The family, their entire family, their friends, everybody is affected by this fighting for the injustice, fighting for the innocence of their loved one. The stigma about around, well, you know, that this is the murderer's family, the rapists. A lot of times the cases are murder and sexual assault. So the stigma around that. And what's even further, so the victim, the actual victim who got killed, did they get justice? The actual perpetrator, they're out. What's happening then? More victims, most of the time, right? So it's not just one person, it's like a snowballing of issues that really affects the whole society. Now, how do we make it better? How do we remedy that? Well, the biggest precaution that the Innocence Project recommends, that Dr. Sol Kassin has proposed and has been proponent of for the longest time, is videotaping. Videotaping not of just the confession, because the confession video is useless. Because if it's taken after this whole process has already taken place, the confession is, you know, it might seem like it's a real one, but it's really not. And actually, videotaping the entire interrogation is what is then going to possibly show that, okay, so was there coercion or did the person actually get that voluntarily? It's only currently practiced in 500 jurisdictions in the US, and that's really not enough. And even in those, sometimes it breaks the video not mandatory. Now, determining after, so once, okay, so you have the confession, but that's not the point where the person, the interrogator should stop, right? They should look at whether or not the evidence actually is congruent with the confession, or, you know, the suspect said, I shot the victim, but the victim was actually stabbed. Or, you know, he said, I went through a back door, but there was no back door. Right? These things, corroborating evidence and guilty knowledge evidence. So things that the suspect needs to volunteer information that the police, that they wouldn't have known had they not been at the crime scene, right? If the police tells the suspect all the evidence and then they incorporate it into the confession, no way to tell. Most European countries, not just in England, coercive techniques and lying are actually forbidden. The U.S. is pretty resistant in terms of making legislation in terms of this process, because they're afraid that people are not going to confess, or that the real culprits are going to avoid confessing. But actually, other countries show us by example that it's not true. And of course, they should definitely allow expert testimony about false confessions. So educating the jury about the presence, the possibility of false confessions, because they are not aware of what happened. And so with that, give the floor to Jeff. Jeffrey Duskin, who is an alum of John Jay's master's program, who is actually a recent recipient of the Distinguished Alumni Award here at John Jay. And he is the director, the director of the Jeffrey Deskowitz Foundation for Justice. He's also currently getting his law degree in Pace Law School. He spent 16 years for a crime that he didn't commit. And so,
actually when I was 16 years old, and cover my story, and I'm going to share some other information about false confessions that Dr. Soroczewski didn't cover, so she left a few things in the head. But I got to say, that was probably the most thorough overview of false confessions I've ever sat in on, and I've spoken at conferences, actually. One I remember once in 2007, which was maybe like 6 months after I had been out, there was an American Psychological Association sponsored event in Texas, of all places. So it was like a 3-day conference, and I had a manager at the time in my speaking career, and we had like a who's who in the audience. I mean, Richard, Saul Kasten was there, and all kind of experts. I mean, it was kind of jokingly called, well, this is almost like the Super Bowl false confessions and interrogations. You know, people are getting up and doing their spiel and presenting their research and their findings, and you know, they're doing the literature review. So you cover all the material that's already known just to set the stage, bring everyone up to speed, and then you come out with your own new research. And so people are doing that, and like the research that they're citing, the people are there in the audience. I mean, it was like kind of like totally unprecedented, you know. So I sat through that, you know, before I got up to do my presentation. So I guess I'm just speaking to context. I've seen, you know, just one example. That was just like awesome. I wish I had this class when I was here. So the year is 1990. Okay, I'm 16 years old, and I'm living in Peekskill, which is in Westchester County, New York. So think about 50 minutes to an hour north of here. Murders were pretty rare. Hadn't been a murder there in maybe like 20 years. So as you might imagine, there were quite a bit of rumors, paranoia. The whole city basically stopped. I mean, parents were coming right to the high school, getting their kids, bringing them straight home. I mean, they were concerned with their own safety, big town hall meetings on safety tips, right? So it was really a big deal. So in high school, I was quiet. I was to myself. I didn't participate in very many organized sports. This made me stick out to my classmates. So in the course of the police investigation, the police spoke to many students from the high school, and some of them told the police that they might want to speak to me because I seemed strange to them. I guess the stereotype is that people that are quiet to themselves, they commit heinous crimes, right? That's the narrative, that's the theme. That's what the police said initially put me on their radar. The other factor which they said attracted them to me, they said that I was overly upset at the victim having been murdered. So in other words, they're saying that my emotional reaction to that was disproportionate to what my actual relationship with the victim was, which is to say, no relationship. She was in two of my classes as a freshman, one as a sophomore. I knew her name, she knew mine, that was the extent of it. I mean, we're not even on a high-vibe basis. So my overly emotional reaction is what was the key there. I'm like, in a Tankman case where no emotional reaction. Saul Castle actually likes to make that point quite a bit. So the other reinforcing factor is that the Peekskill police, they got a profile from a psychological profile from the NYPD, which the profiler said that contained what the psychological characteristics of the actual perpetrator likely were. So as it happened to turn out, I fit that profile. So hence those three factors I'm on the police radar. So for about 6 weeks, the police played this cat and mouse game with me, which half the time they talked to me as if I was a suspect, and half the time they pretended like they needed my help to solve the crime. In fact, when they would push too much with, you know, talking to me as if I was a suspect, and I would withdraw and I would start becoming frightened and I'd want to leave, that's when they would switch gears and, you know, Jeff as the junior investigator helper is what would come about. So they would say things like, the kids won't talk freely around us, but they will around you. Let us know if you hear any rumors. They made me the center of attention. They asked me opinion questions and then would congratulate me on my opinion being correct. They made me feel important. A couple of psychological dynamics were in play at the same time. So I came from a single parent household, and so my dad was never involved in my life in any aspect. So one of the, that directly interacted with the good cop, bad cop technique, in which, otherwise known as Mutt and Jeff, in which, Mutt and Jeff, and I'm Jeff, right? So, in which one officer takes on a more attractive role, and the other one pretends to be opposed to what's going on, yet somehow powerless to intervene. And of course, the purpose of that tactic is that when the person being questioned becomes frightened, it's only natural that you look to a friendly face for assistance. Began to look up to the good cop as a positive adult male role model. Another psychological factor was that my fantasy career, what I wanted to do when I grew up, at least when I was a kid, I mean, later on in my late teens, I switched up and I decided I wanted to be a lawyer. But before that, I wanted to be a cop. And so that this
unexpected early opportunity to do this quasi-police work is along with my age, how they were able to pull the fiction over my eyes. I mean, the idea that a 16-year-old could help solve a homicide is kind of absurd, but it didn't seem that way to me at that point in time. So eventually they got me to agree to take a lie detector test, otherwise known as a polygraph. They told me that some new information had come into the police file and that they wanted to share that with me and that this would put me in better position to help them. So help us to help you to help us, my philosophy. So the next day, rather than go to school, I instead went to the police station where I had heard that other people in the city had been polygraphed. So because it was a school day, neither my mother nor my grandmother realized that I was not in school, so therefore, as far as they knew, everything was just fine, and therefore they didn't walk around looking for me. They drove me to the town of Brewster, which was in Putnam County, whereas I was a native of Peekskill in Westchester County. So it was about 40 minutes away across county lines, and of course that meant that I no longer knew where I was, and therefore was totally dependent upon the police. The police read me my rights, the officer who had been pretending to be my friend, but I never understood them. I didn't understand why they even bothered to read them at all. I mean, after all, I'm here helping you, right? So what does that mean? And, you know, when they would get to the part where it said, if you can't afford a lawyer, anything you say can and will be appointed, can and will be used against you in a court of law, I would start thinking about civil court, like, you know, divorce and civil matters, and I would think to myself, court, what are you talking about? Court, we're not going to court, what are you talking about? So that along with their deception of pretending that I'm helping them, those things along with my just general naiveness, you know, as to what the law is how, why my right, being read my rights really didn't avail me much of anything. So there were three cops that drove with me from Peekskill to Brewster. But then there was also the Putnam County Sheriff's Investigator, Daniel Stevens, who was, as I mentioned, the Putnam County Sheriff's Investigator, but he was dressed as a civilian. He was pretending not to be a cop. He never read me my rights. I never learned that he was a cop until months later. So they gave me a brochure about how the polygraph worked. It was a four-page brochure with a lot of big words in it, which I didn't understand, but I thought, well, so what? I'm here to help the police. Let's just get on with it. Plus, they were telling me that in addition to being more helpful to them and getting this new information in the file, you know, they could finally stop switching to talking to me as if I was a suspect. This would just finally put this annoying thing, you know, to the side. So again, let's just get on with it. So they put me in a small room, and before attaching me to the polygraph, they gave me countless cups of coffee, which seems pretty clear in hindsight. The purpose of that was to get me nervous. I mean, I must have gotten 6 or 7 cups of coffee. The premise of the polygraph is that when a person lies, that you'll become nervous, and that nervousness will result in an increased pulse rate, but it's actually the pulse rate which is measured by the machine. But other factors which would lead to an increased pulse rate would include fear and caffeine. So after finishing the coffee routine, the polygrapher attached me to the polygraph, and it was a kind of a big machine, and now I'm kind of immobilized. It's a small room. And he launches into his third-degree tactics. So he invaded my personal space. He raised his voice at me. He kept asking me the same questions over and over again. He kept getting more and more ferocious as each hour passed. Now, I really wasn't used to talking, interacting with adult males because, as I mentioned, my dad was never involved in my life. And, you know, I was 16, and he was this big mountain of a man. And so it was really a frightening experience. So he kept that up for 6.5 to 7 hours. Towards the end of the interrogation, he said to me, "What do you mean you didn't do it? You just told me through the polygraph result that you did. We just want you to verbally confirm it." So when he said that to me, that really shot my fear through the roof. And it was at that point the officer who had been pretending to be my friend, he came in the room and he told me that the other officers were going to harm me, but that he was holding them off, but he couldn't do so indefinitely. "You have to help yourself here, you understand." Considering I maintained my innocence for the previous 6.5 to 7 hours, it was pretty clear what he meant by that. They wanted me to confess. And he added that if I did as they wanted, that they stop what they're doing, that I could go home afterwards, that I was not going to be arrested. Being young, naive, frightened, 16 years old, not thinking about the long term. I was only concerned with my safety in the moment. And I was in fear of my life. I mean, the fact that I didn't know where I was and that nobody else knew where I was either, that really loomed very large in my mind. And then there was the push-pull dynamic, because on one hand, there was the possibility of harm, but then on the other, he threw me this false life preserver. And so I made a decision. I was desperate to just get out of there and this way out, and I latched onto that, and I believed in this false promise. And so I put together a story based upon information which he had given me that day, and in the 6 weeks run up to it, as well as other items which they had released to the newspaper. But I spoke. I spoke faster than what I could make the story up, and so I wound up collapsing onto the floor, just totally overwhelmed. I curled up into a fetal position. I was crying uncontrollably. Needless to say, despite the promise to the contrary, I was in fact arrested. I was charged with murder and rape. This is kind of where when a confession comes in, the other evidence all gets skewed and overlooked and almost doesn't matter anymore. Because before I went to trial, the results of the DNA test came in from the FBI lab, which showed that semen found in the victim didn't match. But rather than acknowledge they made a mistake, the state continued to prosecute full speed ahead. In order to counter the DNA test, the polygraphist got the medical examiner to commit fraud. I guess he was willing to do that to help the prosecution get a conviction, because after all, he knew I was guilty because I had confessed. So when an autopsy is done, there's written and audio notes which are supposed to be taken at the same time as the findings are made as a way of ensuring authenticity. And so it was only 6 months after doing that autopsy, only after the DNA didn't match me. Hundreds of autopsies later, he remembers that even though he hadn't documented it, he has a clear memory that he found medical evidence to show that the victim had been sexually active, which is what opened the door for the prosecutor to argue that it didn't matter that the DNA didn't come from me, that didn't mean I was innocent. She could have been raped and murdered. She could have consensual sex close enough to the murder and rape so as to explain away the DNA. At the same time, the police also joined in because they also joined in on the fraud, is that they hadn't done enough. They went back into the field and they interviewed 17 witnesses who knew the victim in one capacity or another, and they all told the police that she didn't have a boyfriend, that there was no consensual sex, but the cops purposely didn't document any of that so that those interviews would not have been known and weren't turned over to my lawyer. In addition, they attributed false statements to me. They claimed that I said that I didn't know if the perpetrator ejaculated or not. But that word wasn't in my vocabulary at 16, and that statement only appears in their police reports after the DNA. It doesn't appear in any of their reports on the confession earlier. So they attributed that. They made that up in order to help the prosecution overcome the DNA evidence. At the same time, the public defender that I had was terrible. I was a public defender because my family didn't have any money to hire a private lawyer. Early on, my public defender was trying to urge me to allow him to put an insanity defense in, which I refused to let him do, talking about how a defense lawyer may be influenced by a confession to think the client was guilty. But then at some point, the DNA result came in. It should have been pretty clear to him at that point that I was innocent. But nonetheless, he really didn't defend me. He never spoke to or interviewed or called as a witness my alibi. I was actually playing wiffle ball when the crime happened. He never explained to the jury the significance of the DNA not matching me. He never used that to argue that this so-called confession was coerced and false. He very rarely met with me. When he would meet with me, I would try to explain to him that I was innocent and what happened in the interrogation room. But but he was always shutting me up. One time he told me he didn't care if I was guilty or innocent, but I hadn't decided if I was going with a bench trial, which is decided by a judge, or a jury trial. He came to me one day and told me that the judge came to him off the record and told him to pick a jury because the judge didn't want to be responsible for finding me not guilty. My lawyer was supposed to put that on the record and ask the judge to recuse himself because that's a really biased type of statement. It's improper for the judge to limit what my legal options are. And it also suggests that the judge is feeling some kind of public pressure because every time I made a court appearance, it was a major media moment, and all the coverage was from a guilt-presumptive oriented perspective, which again was influenced by the fact that it was a false confession that was given. My lawyer should have never represented me in the first place because of a conflict of interest. So beyond the prosecutor just going with the consensual sex theory without any legit evidence, he also mentioned in court, he mentioned the name of another student from the high school that he claimed had likely had sex with the victim, but he never called that other student as a witness to give verbal testimony. He didn't have a DNA test performed. Basically, he made an improper argument. You're supposed to have an evidentiary foundation before you make an argument, but he skipped that. And so my lawyer was supposed to really try to subpoena him and ask for DNA test in order to explode that myth, but he couldn't do that because another youth was represented by another member of legal aid. So that conflict of interest prevented him from really zealously advocating for me. When it was time to discredit the medical examiner, which obviously in this case would have been extremely important to do, when it was time for cross-examination, my lawyer stood up in open court and said to the medical examiner, "You're going to be pleased to know that I don't have a single question for you." So he never bothered to cross-examine or discredit. Now, the coerced false confession wasn't videotaped, it wasn't audiotaped, it was no signed confession. I refused to sign the confession because it had a statement in there saying that I swear that there was no coercion and I had been coerced. But because it wasn't audio or videotaped, that meant that the police were allowed to change their story in court, so they left out the threat and false promise, the two illegal things. So I wanted to testify at the pre-trial hearing and put those facts on the record, but my lawyer wouldn't allow me to. He said that he had to decide if I was going to testify at the trial or not, and he didn't want the prosecutor to have the benefit of having prior testimony from me, which he could then use to cross-examine me with at trial. He said that, well, the prosecutor could make it appear as though you're lying, even if you're not. But that didn't really make any sense because, first of all, if the judge believed me, then the statements would have been ruled involuntary, and therefore there wouldn't have been a trial because they didn't have any other evidence. But secondly, if it really went that badly, I didn't have to take the stand, and if I didn't, then they wouldn't be able to use the prior testimony anyway, even if it did go badly. So there really was not much to lose and everything to gain. But nonetheless, he didn't allow me to testify. But then when we got to the trial, he wouldn't allow me to testify there either. He said it wasn't his job to prove I was innocent. It was up to the prosecution to prove that I was guilty. He didn't think that it happened. Well, that's a legal slogan. That's a legal principle, but it doesn't work that way in real life. You know, you're almost presumed to be guilty. You have to try to prove that you're not, or you run a risk of being wrongfully convicted. So basically, he didn't put on defense. Add it all up, I guess it's not too surprising that the jury found me guilty. I will never forget the day I was found guilty because it felt like I was in some sort of nightmarish alternative reality, because to my way of thinking, only guilty people were convicted. But they said what they did, and I was taken into custody. On the day of the sentencing, I begged the judge to overturn the verdict because I was innocent, and I referenced the DNA to support my contention. He actually told me on the record, "Maybe you are innocent," conceding that there was a doubt. I mean, again, how could there not have been a doubt? I mean, they had nothing, just this confession under highly questionable circumstances, and the DNA didn't match me. But that didn't lead him to step up for justice and exercise his discretion by overturning the conviction, which he could have done by overturning any number of rulings he made against me in the course of the trial. Instead, he took the easy, politically expedient way out, which was to sentence me to a term of 15 to life. So I'm going to share with you a little bit about the appellate process and how I was exonerated. So I went to the appellate division. My lawyer argued that I was innocent. That was wrapped around the following legal arguments, that there wasn't legally sufficient evidence, that the prosecution hadn't proven guilt beyond a reasonable doubt, and that the verdict was against the weight of the evidence, which all of which sound kind of reasonable to me. And my lawyer also argued that my Fifth Amendment rights had been violated. And then there were six other issues of law, which I'm going to skip over because it's not really related to what we're talking about today. The appellate division, even without the threat, knowing about the threat of false promise, even without knowing that, they still ruled that I wasn't in custody, that I came and gone freely as I wanted to. And they ruled that there was overwhelming evidence of guilt, and so they ruled against me 5-0. I never again got a substantive ruling after that, although I lost 6 more appeals. They denied the re-argument motion. The Court of Appeals declined to give me permission to appeal to them. The federal court ruled that my being 4 days late, even though the lateness was due to the court clerk giving my lawyer the wrong information, that my being late was more important than my innocence argument and my Fifth Amendment argument. And that ruling was upheld in the next few courts. Ultimately, I was exonerated through further DNA testing, which not only affirmed my innocence, but also identified the actual perpetrator who had killed the second victim 3.5 years later, whereas he was arrested and convicted of the crime. My charges were dismissed on actual innocence grounds. So a couple of quick points, switching gears. In terms of reforms, everything is not just the experts and videotaping interrogations. I mean, videotaping is really the standard answer that you get, and it's true. But an additional important reform, which is backed by Steve Drizin, who's a false confession expert and a lawyer, and is starting to gain a little bit of currency, which is having a pre-trial hearing where the focal point is not simply whether interrogation was whether or not statements were made involuntarily, whether or not Miranda warnings were given, but also whether or not a confession is accurate or not. You know, because clearly the other hearing is fairness law so badly in light of all the wrongful convictions caused by coerced false confession. So super quickly, I'm going to give you known red flags. Confession is false, and there's no study listing all of these. This instead, you would have to know the case histories of DNA exonerations. You can be found at the Innocence Project's website. You have to read all of them and come to it. But I've done that. I'm studying and advocating. So, a lengthy interrogation, particularly when it's combined with food deprivation, is a red flag. And all these are red flags. It means that it deserves greater attention, not necessarily if the confession is false. The usage of there's a polygraph involved, that's a red flag. There's a high correlation between polygraph and false confessions. If it's a co-defendant situation, like the Central Park 5 case, if the co-defendants are giving different stories, then that's an early red flag. If the level of sophistication of the language that's used in the confession, if that exceeds what the formal education and life experience is of a defendant or suspect, then that's another red flag. Just like if a confession is written out by the police rather than the suspect, that's another red flag. If you ever get the chance to watch the documentary Murder on a Sunday Morning, that illustrates that. And that's so powerful. The defense lawyer is churning all these pages with, like 5, 6, 7, lots of pages, all this huge language, all these details. And the defense lawyer is asking him, well, did he write this? Did he write any of this? So none of these words are his. So that's another red flag. Suspect getting the details wrong, that was already illustrated. So the police stopping someone who's confessing and then correcting them, giving them the detail, and then start again. So the John Colbert case, he was 21 years old, and then he was interrogated for 19 hours. And so the police, he confessed 5 different times, right? And then they would stop. Every time he got a detailed wrong, they'd stop him, correct him, and let's take it again from the top, you know? And so it was 5 different versions given before a 6th one was eventually accepted. If the questions are not open-ended questions where the suspect is supposed to fill in the details, but instead it's just yes-no questions, that's certainly a red flag. I mean, the way that you determine if a suspect has guilty knowledge or not is if they come out with details that were unknown. But if all you're asking is yes-no questions, you don't allow that process to continue. Just like if a question has an item in it, and then shortly after that, the suspect incorporates the item into a statement. So I remember a case in Florida, and the police asked the suspect, and this is after he had issued 40 denials in an hour and a half. They asked him, well, what did you hit the victim in the head with? And then a couple of lines below, he gets around to saying, well, I hit the victim in the head with a tire iron. So that was just an example of that. This contamination, that's certainly a red flag. So if anyone is seen making a murderer, if you think about the interrogation of Brendan Dassey, so he was asked at the end, well, what happened to you to her head? And he doesn't know the answer. And then being, I guess, frustrated and just too quick, he says, well, you shot her in the head, right? And he says, yeah. Well, by him saying that you shot her in the head, that's an obvious example of contamination happening. Certainly the youth, somebody who's young or has mental health issues, those are all red flags. Some people with mental health issues, they know that they have the issues, so they try to compensate for that by being compliant with authority figures. So lots of other things I wanted to share with you, but you know, time is upon us, at least my portion of it. We have another really exciting guest here with us from New Jersey. I'll let him tell his story, but I will yield the floor, and thanks for listening.
Very well put together, very informative. Photocopy everything. I intend to go back and study later. Okay, I would appreciate that. Also, I would like to say that Jeffrey Deskovich, upon my exoneration, is one of the people that I credit with helping me with my reintegration back into the community. As an exoneree, sometimes we face different type of obstacles with reconnecting with back in the community. And Jeff, through his foundation, embraced me and pretty much put me on a path where I'm on today to do public speaking and work and move as an advocate. Now I work closely with the Innocent Project in their public speaking bureau. And so I'd like to take the time to thank Jeff at this moment for what you've done for me. So. And speaking about the false confession, my situation was a little different in regards to I wasn't arrested on the crime that I was falsely accused of. I was arrested on a different crime. I was arrested on a assault charge. With particular czar, me and a friend, I'm a drilling junkie, so to speak. I like speed, so we got us a motorcycle. Together. At the time I had a car, so I, you know, being a good guy, I said, you go ahead, you ride, and when I want to come get it, I, you know, later on. A couple months went by, the season got, motorcycle season got warm. I went to go ask for it. He said no. I got mad. So we started fighting, and police got called, and I was ultimately arrested. Now, while in the county, for that charge, I was charged with the charge of kidnapping sexual assault, which I had no idea what went on. Now, before I go into that, I wanted to go into the aspect of the false confession that relates to a lot of what was displayed. One part of it is, everything was already put together before I got there. Before I knew anything, the case was already assembled. The arresting officer, or the officer who wrote the report, had already wrote the report, got all the warrants, and had everything submitted before anyone even approached me. So I had no role in the interrogation. I had no interrogation. There was no, I had no participation in any of that. So, come to find out later on that everything was fabricated, but however, that process took place in my absence. You got a lot of times, you got, like in my community, you know, I come, young black man, I'm from Newark, New Jersey, grew up in Newark, New Jersey, so those are the urban communities, we call them the hood, so, you know, and a lot of times our interaction with law enforcement is not as easy going as people think. So because of that, that whole aspect of them arresting me and me participating and me being in a confession, I didn't have that opportunity. Everything is normally done before you get there. If you're not arrested, that whole belief system that the police is right and you're wrong, that's entrenched in our community. Once the police say you did it, there's no way you go against that. You're guilty. And unless you're able to somehow down the line advocate your innocence before you're arrested. Now for myself, while I was in the county waiting to be adjudicated on the assault charges, they called me down to the bullpen area. That's the area where you meet with your lawyer. He's on one side of the window, you're on the other, this side of the window. You know, the public defender, I don't know why they got a plexiglass between you and your lawyer. I don't understand that related here, but I guess history has indicated that these relationships become very turmoil-ridden. So he's telling me now, I'm thinking, okay, this guy, he's going to let me know that I'm about to go home. You know, I'm only here for like simple assault, you know. The only reason I'm arrested because, you know, I wanted to fight, so the guy, he looked a little bit, he was beat up once, and they took me. And so he starts to tell me that you've been charged with kidnapping, sexual assault. At that point, things change. My whole attitude, my whole mindset, because now I'm like, what are you talking about? I'm here for this. You got the wrong guy. I'm like, listen, you got to shoot the call off. You need to let me out of here because he got to see somebody else. I wait, my lawyer must be somewhere down there. I must walk in the wrong room. He's like, no, your name is Rodney Barbers. We have these charges that have been filed against you. And I'm like, listen, I've been in here. How did I do any of that? I didn't do any of that. I don't know what you're talking about. I'm adamant about trying to let him know I'm innocent. I mean, I'm saying this because I'm shocked, first of all. I don't even know how to respond because I think I'm being punked. I'm looking for the camera. Maybe somebody cracks some joke. Playing a joke on me. However, I don't know what's going on because I'm trying to understand the process of things. And so he's like, no, this is, you need to, you know, pay attention to this. It's really going, you know. So I said, okay, well, look, now I'm trying to understand this. I'm trying to get a grip on everything. I'm trying now to figure out what's going on because he's adamant about saying I'm the guy. And now I'm trying to, the seriousness kicks in. And so I'm like, well, look, you know, I need to, who did they say I did this to? So he reads the police report and he says, oh, you walk down the street and you grabbed her and dragged her down. I'm like, wow, I did all this? So I'm like, this is wrong. So he said, look, this is what I'm gonna do for you. You go in the courtroom, this is for arraignment. and we're gonna try to figure this out. So he's my lawyer. He's the only person that seems to be on my side in this matter of God. And he said, oh, we're gonna figure it out. So I refused to go in the courtroom. I said, I'm not going in there. He said, what do you mean not going? I said, I didn't do this. I'm not gonna dignify. So they got clever. What they did was the bailiff, I'm standing in the bullpen area, which is an area where the prisoners held, and he got the bars, and the courtroom is there. He opened the door. And so the judge yelled from the bench, how do you plead? I said, not guilty. Judge, that's good enough for me. They closed the door, and that was my arraignment. So I took me back downstairs. Now I'm so overwhelmed with the situation, I called my family, thinking that they're gonna help me get some answers. They don't, what are you talking about? We don't know what to do. We don't have money to get you a lawyer. How are we gonna handle this situation? So now I'm in custody. I'm in the county, Essex County Jail, surrounded by other prisoners. I mean, they just living their life, trying to figure out how they're gonna get out. There's hostility there. I'm trying to understand why is this happening to me. Going back and forth, pacing through, asking questions. So 2 months go by. Then another lawyer called me down. So I go, I'm happy. A lawyer called me down. I'm talking to somebody now, I'm getting out of here. Now, this time, I have sat time and think of some more detailed questions to ask. I'm gonna ask some good questions. I don't look at a couple episodes of Law and Order, legal and all that. So I'm ready now. So I said, well, what about this? Get the DNA. Get the, I want the discoveries. I start, I'm Denny Crane. And so, this, that. And so he said, oh, okay, I got you. Slow down, I'm gonna take care of all that. He's gonna do this for you. He wrote everything down for me. Like, it was really, I said, well, I'm getting out of here now. I left going and do, you know, I really went down there and showed him that I know my stuff. So, 2 more months go by. 3 months go by. Now I'm starting to feel the pinch of being there because I had just got a nice apartment in Montclair, New Jersey. I just got custody of my son. Just got a nice job, a new job at Quell's Menswear, Woolbrook Mall. They was paying me great, and I'm a great salesman, so I was getting extra bonus. I was doing all right. I was feeling the pinch of this. And I lost my job. My son now is gonna gotta go with his mother. Everything that I work for is collapsing. I want to go home. I didn't do this. I'm innocent. This is not shouldn't be happening. So I'm starting to feel that pressure. I'm starting to get a little overwhelmed. So they called me back to court. This is the third time. I said, go to this lawyer. This is another lawyer. I said, yo, what happened to the other guy? Oh, I don't know him. Let's do this. This lawyer, though, was so theatrical. And his presentation, how he came in, oh, Mr. Roberts, come over here. Now, mind you, you in the bullpen with 40, 50 other prisoners, standing right there, you over here, they all right here listening. There's no confidentiality whatsoever. So you standing there with the bars, y'all talking, they acting like, trying, but they all listening. So he's telling me, he's like, listen, they got you. Witness is outside and ready to testify against you. You've been positively identified. The prosecutor is ready to go to trial right now if you don't plead guilty. Plead guilty? Wait a minute. What do you mean? Slow down. I'm trying to. Now, things have gotten completely out of hand. So, this is my lawyer, the person who I thought was entrusted to guide me through this situation, telling me that they got me. I mean, you ain't even say we can win or we gonna go to trial or we gonna fight this. He's like, they got you. I'm like, well, listen. So he said, yeah, if you don't go, they offer you, they ready to give you a life sentence. When I heard that, everything started. We mean life sentence. I mean, are you talking about me being here the rest of my life for a crime I ain't commit? Mr. Roberts, they got you. This is what they gonna do. So let me go. Let me try to work this out for you. I'm like, well, yeah. Go work this out. You should go, So now I'm in there pacing back and forth. I'm scared to death. And I'm going to go, I'm like, oh, Mr. Johnson just said, I'll be here the rest of my life. He's some of the witness out there, somebody I never even met before, saying I did something, I'm not even telling what's going on. I'm going back and forth, and now everybody in guys in the bullpen was listening, like, yeah, man, you know, man, y'all need to leave me alone right now. You know what I'm saying? So I'm trying to understand. So he comes back in, this time, he really lays it on. He come in, his tie crooked, the actions was amazing. His tie crooked now, he got all these papers ruffled, like he was out there fighting, shirt halfway out, right? So I'm like, what's going on? He's like, yeah, man, I got you the good plea agreement. Plea agreement? I thought you was going to work this out, I'm innocent. He's like, listen, stop it. Stop it, they got you. You need to really understand you're going to be here the rest of your life. You're not going home no more if you don't listen to me and you try to go take this to trial. And I'm like, well, you got, and at this point, all I'm seeing is my future, my life. Now, he said, okay, you plead guilty. They're going to dismiss the sexual offense. Downgrade the kidnap to second degree. Give you 7-year sentence, you'll be home in 2 years. Other than that, they're saying the rest of your life. Now, I'm sitting here, like, I'm caught between the dynamics of who I'm going to trust more, Satan or Lucifer? You know, Satan, because you want me to plead guilty to a crime I didn't commit, and Lucifer, if I don't do it, I'm spending the rest of my life in jail. So I'm trying to figure out who's going to treat me better, Satan or Lucifer. So I'm like, I'm thinking about my son, I'm thinking about my future, I'm thinking about my family. So he said, well, they got to put on the record that no one got hurt. That no one on the record, you was the victim of least unarmed. So in my mind, I'm trying to grab for things to convince myself that I should plead guilty. I should take this plea agreement to help myself. I'm thinking that I'm saving my life. And I was one of them people that said, I'm not pleading guilty to a crime I can commit. You know, dubbed out with pick the jury, pick the 12. You know, I'd rather be carried by 60. You know, I don't want all that, you know, you're saying, but when I'm sitting there faced with the concept that I'm going to be in jail for a crime I commit forever, and I'll never be back out to walk the streets, be with my son, to be with my loved ones, to do the things I wanted to do. Oh, I could take this 2 years, he's saying, and I could do this 2 years, and I could come home and fight this back on the streets. I'm not going to be. In my mind, I thought I was saving my life. I felt so overwhelmed that it pained me to do it, but I got to do this. So I said, come on, let's talk about the plea agreement. He felt like he had it. He had it, and he didn't. So I'm like, but I'm doing this so sad, because the feeling that I had was like, I had to do this. So I still held on to some hope. Because now they have taken me to the judge, in front of the judge. So the judge is saying, this is what really convinced me that I had to do this. Because the judge said, well, I'm glad you took this plea agreement, young man, if you did it. If you went to trial and I found guilty, I was going to sentence you to the highest range of sentence. I'm like, this judge is saying this to me. And my mom, like, what is going on here? Why me? What do you want to do this destroy me for? And, you know, it was not even about me. It was about the system of things. So I pled guilty to the crime I had committed based on the coercive factors that came with me. One, I'm sitting in jail all this time waiting for some adjudication. Now, they said they could hold me the rest of my life. They already proved that because I was locked up for the crime I had committed. So obviously they could hold me because I was in jail. So that portion of the belief system was already established. Two, my lawyer, this person is my advocate, was the one who persuaded me and coerced me. I never met the prosecutor. I never talked to the prosecutor not one time. Was the one who coerced me. And a third, the judge, the person who was the overseer of this whole circus, is the one who is saying to me, I'm going to give you the rest of your life in jail if you go to trial.
So all these things became so overwhelming to me, and I believed, you know, that this was going to happen because I had my friend Pookie. He went to jail, he ain't come home, and such and such, he did. I seen him get locked up, and he ain't do what they said he did, and he's still locked up. And all these things in my mind is growing like, yo, it's real to me. I made it real to me because of this, how coercive and how suggestive and how impactful things came up to me. It was about pure feeling. It was about the psychological effect of being in jail, and now all the people in authority is telling you that if you do not do this, you will not be going home. So I plead to 7 years for a crime I ain't committed. Now, 7 years, I served 17 years. All, that was the total number of years. I served 17 years before I was exonerated. Now, how this happened, when I was sentenced, all right, they sentenced me and sent me to state prison. I went to the parole board. All right, so I was, at that point, I went to prison very angry because I felt that I had betrayed myself. So I had really mad at me. I felt like I threw me under the bus. So I had like a chip on my shoulder. It's like, I didn't want to talk to him. I don't know, you get out of here. They just called me angry man because I was angry, you know, at me. So anything that happened to me, I felt I deserved. So I had to get past that phase. Once I got past, you know, processing things a little differently, stop getting in trouble. So I went to parole board. 2 years went by. I go to parole board. They say, well, you're here for your sexual assault. But I said, oh, I didn't do that. I pled guilty. They dismissed that. Oh, no, they said, oh, no, that's part of the record. You have to, this is what they say you did. You have to admit you did this to show. I said, listen, I'm not guilty. I didn't do any of that. Once I started saying this to the parole board, I was denied parole three times. So they did it with me, 7 years go by. See, I'm studying law now. I was in law library, I filed this motion. I withdraw my guilty plea. I'm doing everything I can to get back in court, to get back in front of the judge, because they lied to me. You told me that I was gonna go home 2 years and that these charges were dismissed. Kind of find out, none of that was. So I get back, I teach myself how to type, teach myself how to do research, teach myself how to shepherdize, teach myself the difference between the blue book, what is primary or secondary law. I had to educate myself in a prison law library. The degree where I got very good. I would start helping other prisoners with their cases. And I became popular as a paralegal. So in the process of doing that, 7 years go by, I'm about to be released, 2004. Now, I had to go to the parole classes to be released. So I was ready. I'm going home now. I was the best parole class guy they had. I was going in with my pencils. I was taking notes. I was diligent, learning how to write resumes. I was doing interviews. I was doing everything because I'm going home. My mindset was that I'm going home to get out and stay out. You know, these are my opportunities. On the day of release, I'll never forget this day. They called my name. Roberts, come on. Broke my leg. So, me and like 14 other guys standing right here. Family on this side. They call their name. Such. They all line up. Such. They go over there. Such. They go over there. So, then they stop calling my name. And I'm still standing. All of them over there. And I'm still right here. So I said, hey, oh, you stopped. I'm right here. Well, he said, oh, well, I'm waiting for some information on you. I'm like, I don't have no more time. The day is the last day. Tomorrow my sentence is over. At 12 o'clock, I have no more time to serve. Oh, I got you. Hold on. All I'm leaving. I'm standing by myself, still holding my back. This is getting late. He says to me, they call me in the room. We got a petition to have you civilly committed. In New Jersey, they had passed a law called the Sexual Violence Predator Act, where they built this facility called the Special Treatment Unit, and this law was between the Department of Correction and the Department of Human Service that if you have a sexual related offense, that you, if you didn't showing remorse or they felt you were still dangerous, that they could hold you simply. This is not even a criminal, my criminal sentence is over. So I was taken to this civil commitment facility, which I was there 10 years, but in hell. And I'm like, where the hell? You know, I'm trying to figure this out. When they say, you got to be held in civil commitment, I don't know what to do at this point. I want to wild out. But I'm learning all my behavior modification techniques. I'm trying to, you know, keep making the situation worse because now I'm trying to think through the situation. I'm not the same young guy I was, after 7 years of experience had told me, just try to process and think through it. So I'm thinking they transfer me to the civil commitment unit. I get there and I don't know what the world has turned into at this point. Because the place was the most horrible experiences of my life. Because here in this facility, I'm surrounded in only the specific charge of sexual offense. It was so hard, it was so difficult as me as a man to be there because it was hard to deal with. Now, I'm gonna tell you why in a minute. But when you're there, you assigned a lawyer because you have what's called civil commitment hearings. Every year you get a hearing. But when you first get there, you're temporarily civilly committed. You're not permanently civilly committed. I stayed in that phase, temporarily civilly committed, 3.5 years. They know what to do with it. Because I was only gave hold because I went out and admit guilt to the crime I didn't do. Because they kept saying, you did that, so I didn't do it. So, they assigned me a lawyer, John DeWar, great guy, public defender. He came in the room, I said, listen, I'm tell you what happened. This is the truth, man, I can't tell you. I pled guilty to a crime I ain't committed. This is what I did, this is why I did it, this is what, he believed it. He took a chance. He went and found the victim, took my picture to her, and this investigator said, this guy, riding here. She said, who is that? She said, I've never seen this guy before in my life. He said, like, no, he's there. They said you positively identify him. You start crying and you was in the courtroom waiting. She said, I didn't even know anyone was locked up. She had no idea anyone having been arrested on the offense. Now here I am believing that she was positively identifying me. She was out in the courtroom crying, couldn't find out she knew. They said, will you give a certified statement? She said, yeah, sure. This is not the guy. I don't know who this is. Gave a certified statement. I thought for sure I was getting out of the civil commitment facility now. That wasn't enough. Because in civil commitment, the degree of evidence changed. It's no longer your lawyer. It's psychologist and psychiatrist who determine your guilt. Once a psychiatrist say you're guilty, based on the record, I find that my findings in the professional that this person committed this offense, even if the offense is dismissed, is a conviction and some under civil commitment. So you're guilty. And you have to fight against a medical report as opposed to anything else. So we thought that was going to be enough. It wasn't. Okay, now my lawyer, now people start believing me now because now the victim is saying I'm not the person. So once that happened, I filed post-conviction relief. Post-conviction relief, PCR, in New Jersey, I was out of town, but I still filed it. The court denied me. The original judge who sentenced me to the plea, I appealed. The appellate division reviewed the record and said, listen, you know what? We're going to relax the time bar and send it back. But this time, we send it back and give him a full evidentiary hearing. So I get. They sent me down. That means I had an opportunity. The victim came in, the detective who wrote the police report came in, and the lawyer who misrepresented me had to come in and testify. So, then myself. So when I got up there, I testified first. And I straight up, the judge said, well, I said, well, I didn't do it. So the judge said, well, you lied to me then? Yes, John. I told you what the lawyer told me, I was lying. I did not do it. Yes, I'm lying. So he was like, okay, well, you just go put on record that you lied to me. Yes, put that on record. I lied to you. So There's a young lady, the victim came up and she testified. So she stood, she got on the stand. The prosecutor said, do you see the young man or the person who assaulted you? She said, no. They're in the courtroom, what are you talking about? Mr. Robbins right there. She said, I don't know who that is. I never seen him a day in my life. He is not the guy. She got mad. She said, let him go, because you, the person who did this to me, is still running around, you holding this guy. She became like an advocate for me. I thought, well, for sure, I'm harsh. So then the lawyer got on the stand, who represented him, and admitted that he was in the seminar mode. He told him that I had 40, 50 cases, and like 20 of them was in the bullpen. I had, my caseload was overwhelmed. I was just trying to get people in and out. He admitted on record that he, I could have did what I did because I just wanted to get out. Then the detective got on and still to this story. Well, yeah, she came and she came to the police station and pointed him out. Everybody, like she just said, she didn't do that. You know, she, well, I don't know what she talking about. Well, they were, where, they so she signed a photo. They said, well, where's the photo? Oh, we lost it. We can't find it. What? Now, issue of DNA come up. So I said, well, let's take the DNA. Because after every sexual assault is a rape kit time. So I'm asking for DNA. Kind of find out all the evidence is, they say this is gone. We lost it. So for a period of like 8.5 years, they were saying they lost the evidence. So I kept on filing motion after motion, appeal after appeal. So the appellate division became so frustrated with the lower court, because I'm telling you, if you meet a judge, and I tell anybody that, that can admit they made a mistake, you met some like mythical thing. unicorn, that don't make folks exist, because judges do not do admit this. So the appellate court got frustrated and they assigned me a new judge and a new lawyer, because I could no longer be represented by the public defender's office. I got a new judge, Sherry Hunter Henderson. Got a new lawyer, Michael Pasicari, young lawyer. Just graduated from Seton Hall. Ooh, that's my man. He came in there, he wore gloves in the court. You know, young Italian guy. He was, came in. He was like, I have this. I love this guy. You know, he started talking, you know, you know, we need to take a second look at this DNA. And he was so suave, you know what I'm saying? I like this guy, yeah, I like this guy. So he convinced the court to allow him to file a motion to go get to look for the evidence again. Lo and behold, the evidence popped up. This big giant box, and they said they always overlooked it. I overlooked the big old box. But at the same time, one side of me was really mad. Then the other side, the devil and the angel, was really like, hey. So one side was like, yeah, they do the hell ton. You know, it's how, I'm going to the world. But now I'm feeling good because I know I'm going home now. Now, this is the evidence I need to prove my innocence. So they take the box, they send it to the state lab. State lab, New Jersey has one of the best state labs. And, you know, so when that came back, Mr. Roberts was exonerated, completely exonerated. And he matched in DNA material. Oh. I can't begin to tell you so, how that made me feel. I was overwhelmed. So he brought me back to court, and the judge, first they brought the scientist in. And it's another, scientists are very arrogant. It's very arrogant. The prosecutor asked the scientist, are you sure you're about your find? Oh, this is how dare you? They vacated my conviction. But the thing about it was, the judge was what the judge said about it. The judge's heartfelt apology that made me come trying to stand hold their stand firm, that made me break down. And plus, when they see said, you're innocent. My family and friends, they were out there. Because a lot of people, of course, it's back to having church. So that was one, but the whole process of things was the evidence, the way into the I'm finding out that all these reports are fabricated, that the warrants that were getting, God, received were fabricated. Everything was proven to be fabricated in a coercive nature in which the public defender and the state collaborated along with the judge to get me to plead guilty is something that always has to be put in the forefront, because it happens so much in so many communities where there's underprivileged and underdeveloped and low income. It happens more than people will know, and we need to continue to take a look at that. So I'm Rodney Robbins.
I was compensated financially in New York City. You can get compensation in state court and then also in federal court. Rodney's case is underway. Any other questions? I want to enjoy my life as much as I can, and I can't do that if I'm angry or bitter. And plus, I feel like I lost so much. Why would I want to, in effect, give the rest of my life to the vehicle that will enable me to do that? Is I take that energy and I channel it into the advocacy work.
I work out, ride.
I take and I do the same. I just have, you know, I am angry, but I have found ways to take that anger and turn it into what I do today. I tell a story, and I tell it in a way where it's kind of moving in order to keep myself from crying. Because when I used to say it, tell it, it's so hurtful to bring another thing that it became too much. But I had to find a way to process it with, you know, so that's how I do it.
Thank you for sharing everything.
And
also,
I've never heard of it. Even in here in New York, in Brooklyn, where retired detective Scarcella, you know, used the same drug addict as the sole eyewitness of six or seven different homicides. Even him has never been charged with anything. So no, that's difficult.
And in fact, usually even if there is evidence and the conviction is overturned, they would insist that reopening the case. There are cases that are being fought over and over again. So.
Okay. All right, I guess that's enough. Okay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.